But thank you for coming to Coffee and Conversation today. This is another great installment in the series. I want to just thank Sterling Society for putting this whole thing on. They are a fundraising arm of the Fine Arts Center, so we try to do a lot of good outreach and just bring in a little bit of extra revenue to support the arts, and especially the whatever is happening here, programs and infrastructure. I also want to thank Sarah Kessinger. Sarah and John actually underwrite this particular artist talk series, so it's thanks to them that we have coffee to go with our coffee and conversation. And then my name is Dina Hurst. My job with this whole venture is really just to find good local artists to come and share their process, their creativity, their wisdom, their lessons learned, for those of you who are interested in hearing. We have today with us Ezra Johnson. Ezra is an associate professor at USF, painting and drawing, but you're gonna see that he does a lot more than just paint and draw. So one of the fun things that he does that I thought was intriguing was animations, and we'll get to see a little sample of that. But he also works across other media as well, like all of our artists, internationally known, nationally known, has exhibited in galleries in the US, around the world. And just a really good artist in his own right, and obviously an art educator as well. So that's something we appreciate too. So Ezra, I will turn it over to you.
Thank you, Dina. It's all yours. Hi, thank you, everyone. Thanks for having me. This contraption. My name is Ezra Johnson, and I consider myself a painter primarily, although my work has branched out into sculpture and animation. But I would say always kind of with painting and my kind of obsession with painting as a topic or subject. Let's see if this works. Yep. So first, these are some early works. Going back a good while, I used to work more from photography, which I don't allow myself to do anymore for several reasons. But one thing, I mean, I still like this painting, which I think is from maybe 2005, so it's pretty old. What I like about it is the atmosphere, you know, and that's something that interests me. It's always interested me, and I it's through color, careful modulation of color, that I attain like an atmosphere. This is like same time period. I think one thing that at least a lot of my painter friends and I have in common is there's always this sort of hunt for subject matter. And I'm interested in subject matter that like I haven't seen before. And one thing I love about painting is you know, how flexible it is and how you can kind of invent something new with it. I'm not saying that like this is the first time ever somebody's painted an airplane. But for me, I was excited by the idea of these screens, of combining painting from my imagination with photography. The screens are actually like little, I think, magazine cutouts or that I enlarged and pasted onto the canvas. So that dynamic between painting and technology and so on. This is also an older one. I haven't seen this one forever. It came up at auction recently, and I was like, oh yeah, I forgot about that painting. This is from when I lived in New York, and I was going to a lot of openings and parties and stuff, and I guess I got kind of obsessed with the idea of creating a space out of with exposed brick and sort of the kind of monotony and playfulness of of using that structure to create a space, and then just everyone smoking and drinking. So it's that. This also goes back. So I'm showing you some of my kind of like formative work while I was searching for subject matter, which I still am, I would say, but I can't remember. I think this one's called No War. But this is from back in like, this was Iraq War days. So this is pretty old. We're gonna jump ahead. And I put this one in. I also do a lot of drawing. I don't show them very much. Every once in a while I do. This is ink on paper. But I think that often, because we want like to create a cohesive style, we'll sort of box ourselves in as artists. I don't know how many of you guys are artists, but I personally find that feeling really uncomfortable. And so this painting is kind of about that, about like being stuck in a box and not really liking it. It also, it's an absurd, I mean, I like to try to, if possible, get some humor into my work. It doesn't always happen, but for some reason, well, in the winter, like all the security details in New York sit in these like boxes, and it's such a strange sight. They're there all night long, and it's so dark, and then the thing is glowing. It's really dramatic. So, so I made this man in the box. It's called. But it, for me, it had a double meaning. But I also did it from my imagination. I mostly work from memory or drawings and not photography. So this brings in a piece that I did a while back that was a big breakthrough for me. It was my first painting animation, and this is a detail from it, or just a still frame from it. It's called What Visions Burn. And I'll show you a couple short excerpts of it, from it, if they will play. So it's an art heist video. I think I should do this little arrow out of the way, to the side there. And let's see, I think I have to push the button over here to make it work. So it's stop frame animation. So like there's six or seven different cameras to make the movement. And then this effect was like using actual video, but like filming it really small so it looked really bad. This is the very first sequence I did. And it's charcoal and oil paint. So basically, the film What Visions Burn follows this art thief, who's a painter. He's like, there's shots of him painting, and then he goes out and steals paintings. And it's like 20 minutes long. It was an insane project. I worked, I don't know, like 20 hours a day on it for months. And it ended up being my MFA, my master's project. So this is kind of like a final heist, and it's a little And the car chase, this will date the film, the car chase that happens, I sequenced from the Bourne Identity film. I don't know if you'll be able to see that. How do I play it? Okay, there we go. This is based on the Frick Museum in New York. Anyone that's been there, it's a phenomenal museum. Really, this should be like an hour long, slowly getting darker, but I didn't want it to be that boring. It's like a little Titian painting. Always wanted to have that painting.
The floor sort of thing.
That's a Velasquez.
Yeah.
They don't let you borrow them.
Excuse me, for every cell, you took a different photo on the same painting?
Yeah.
Is that how it worked?
Yeah, so it's like so many photos.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's moving paint, sometimes I do collage bits. Thank you. Good. A lot of things in the artist studio are highly flammable. Moving forward, this image, I like to show this image because it shows like some of the complexity of the process of it, the animation process that I've developed. This was for a later video called What Birds Remember, If They Do Remember. And I went back to the Northwest and kind of grew and got, like, that's where my dad is from and where I partially grew up. And I set the animation there. But to make this shot, which is a recurring shot, just like the building going up one and Let Vision Burn is a recurring shot, I wanted the sunlight to have an effect, but that it, glazing yellow over like all the dark pine trees wouldn't do it. So I painted the thing inverted. I painted like black as white. I reversed it. So that way the sunlight could be blue. And then I went into Photoshop and I inverted each image. So this is what it looks like in the film. Anyway, so there's a lot of kind of like figuring out how to do things in order to make the effect happen. And it's all done in a really DIY way, but it's also quite complicated and labor intensive. This is a like detail shot. In the film, these things kind of bob up and down. There's a lot of logging up there in Washington State. This little bird is kind of a character that hangs out and comes back in the film repeatedly. And let's see, this might be the shot I have from it. I'm basically showing you like 1% of the work I've made. For me, the painting and the animation and sculpture, it's very much about material exploration. It's that, I would say that's equally important to the subject matter. And I think, meaning like the material, the color, you know, just the physicality of it. Okay, so jumping into some sculptural work, I was living in London, and I noticed, just like here, people leave their mattresses out on the street there. But I noticed theirs like were really pretty. Like they had you know, like a plaid on it or stripes. It's probably just like the, I don't know, the IKEA or something. But I started to see them as like funny paintings or surrogates for paintings. And I thought, why don't I try making that? So it's kind of like, I had already spent a lot of time making sculptural objects, kind of related to the still life paintings I've done. But these are much bigger, they're life size, and they're basically wood and canvas and paint. They're kind of like a stretched canvas, but stretched on a weird shape and then painted. So this is something that I sort of have been coming back to for the last 10 years sculpturally. But I do see it as an extension of painting. When I first moved to Florida, which was 10 years ago, I had a solo project at Untitled Art Fair in Miami, and I made a mattress for it. And this one, I don't know if you guys know, well, in the art, this diamond pattern, we call it the Harlequin pattern, and it refers to especially early Picasso, the Rose period. If you don't know the Rose period of Picasso, you should really look at it. It's one of the most beautiful periods of his early work. But it's been riffed on by many artists, Jasper Johns for one. I guess it's a combination of structure. It defies the grid, which is something that painters have been long obsessed with. But it's a more playful structure. So anyway, I decided to make this a Harlequin mattress. And it's also wood and canvas painted. I think there's some Bondo in there to like make it seamless. It goes all the way around. Here's a little, some shots of it when it was more blank, like when I finished the form, which took me weeks, and then the painting of it was really fun. And then there were some kind of goofy mattress paintings that went with it in the Untitled Fair. And then I got into dishcloths, which is, I don't know, I just, you know, sometimes in art, you just like start pulling a thread and then you just kind of keep going with it. And I like how dishcloths, once you like wash something and then you wring it out and then you leave it on the edge of the sink to dry, it becomes like a little sculpture. It becomes hard and you can stand it up. And I got really into that. And so I made these giant ones. And this was a show in 2016 in New York. I had these dishcloths and I made all these tiny ceramic ones, which, they're made out of porcelain painted with a slit, different, just yellow, pink, and blue. And yeah, it was quite a big installation. But I also had paintings in the show too. So it was kind of this whole thing in my head, kind of like, I don't want to say undermining painting, but like playing with painting. It's such a serious endeavor. Okay, I kept doing, I don't know, sorry, I'm leaving the microphone, but I feel like you guys can probably hear me. Okay, I don't have to stay right there. Yeah, I kept making mattresses, and then I was thinking of this song lyric. It balances on your head like a mattress balanced on a bottle of wine. I don't know, does anybody know that song? Well, I like that lyric, so and I thought I just like got an image from it. So I made this mattress balance on a bottle of wine. I have a better shot of it, but I wanted to show. I've always made these wooden sculptures of products, little objects from the supermarket. I didn't really show you guys that them, but I made like hundreds of them. And I still make them every once in a while, and I've shown them like exclusive, like had product shows. Yeah, here's the first mattress that I was on a bottle of wine. So, I mean, it's, you know, it's a painting. I like work the surface really hard. There's a lot of Bondo in that surface, which I got into that color of Bondo. It's kind of got this like dry pink color. And it reminds me a little of fresco, which is, you know, painting into wet plaster. That's what they did on church walls like back in the Renaissance or whatever. But you trowel on the plaster, and while it's still wet, you have to put, you know, inject the pigment in there or brush the pigment on there, and then it gets trapped in there. That's how Giotto made the Arena Chapel. But anyway, there's something about the surface, that dryness, and they get all messed up and like broken. They look, kind of look better that way. The Bondo reminded me of that, and I got really into that. So there's always these dialogues in my mind that go back to different histories of painting that maybe you wouldn't entirely know on your own, but they're there and they're very important to me. Here's another one. Another mattress balance on bottle one. Sorry, it's not a great photo. I need to get a better photo. This is at the Nerman Museum of Art in Kansas. And then here's another painting of the mattress, but this is from an animation. So it like circles into my work in weird ways. And I'm going to show you a little bit of this animation called Stranded in a House, which is also from a song lyric from the same singer. I'm gonna move ahead. Basically, all these paintings that make up this animation are done on top of IKEA pages of IKEA catalogs and interior design catalogs. But I'll move ahead because there's some repetition, so I'll just let it go ahead. It goes in a loop forever. I think I'm gonna redo this, like, better resolution, because I don't know what's going on, and I really like the idea of this piece, so with a better camera, better lighting, I'm gonna redo it. That might be the project I do between now and New Year. Thank you. sometimes there's no door, and I'll just like make a door, and you just believe it, because it doesn't, like, it's... Sorry, I thought I had advanced it. I think it's almost done now. Starts over and it just goes back into it forever, for all eternity. Another image that's kind of recurred in my work, which also points back to painting, is like the sign or billboard, because it's like a big canvas, or it could be a projection screen. This is a little while back, a couple of billboard paintings that I showed in Miami at Mindy Solomon Gallery down there. And then this is harking back to that What Visions Burn, my first animation. Here's a little shot of billboards in the show at Mindy Solomon Gallery. You can see that it's a much nicer wall than the one in my studio. And this is fun. I got to do this like big survey in Los Angeles in 2018. And they showed like 25 videos on different screen projections, and I think it was 22, and smaller monitors, and it was it became like a really carnival-esque kind of installation, and I got like a big LA Times profile. It was really cool. So I'll show a little walkthrough of it. There might be some swear words that appear, so if you're, you might have to cover your eyes. Because I had this piece that had some swear words in it. But anyway, so this is just like a walkthrough of that installation at Young Projects in Los Angeles. And one of the billboards that opened the show up. You can hear that Paganini violin piece from What Visions Burn playing there. It was very jumbled, but the sound kind of overlapping, and it became like this, my own world, sort of, I don't know, it was a great experience. Yeah, sorry about that. That one, they projected against this mirror, so it like doubled. I kind of like the look of that. The mirroring. There's that very end of What Visions Burn that I showed you already. the gallery opening scene from What Visions Burn? That's in the beginning of it. Remember, it's an art heist film, so there's a lot of art world references in there. And beards have become like really trendy, so I was sort of addressing that. So I pardon my camera work. Tropics, it's different, but you have the, like, the look is similar, it's very horizontal, and you have the palm trees and the heat, but then it's like, I don't know, it's strange. Here's an idea of another version of gas chicken. This is a chicken in the sink. This is an homage to one of my favorite painters, Alice Neal. She did a chicken still life, so I one updated. And still life, I'm not showing you that many, but still life has all through my career played a big part in it. I've done countless still lifes. Oh, I live on the Hillsborough River, and this is an actual boat. It's, somebody told me it's Captain John, is the guy who owns the boat, and so it's Captain John's boat. He lives upriver from me, and this is what it looks like. There's another still life. This one's quite large, kind of a night still life. Interested in like dealing with the atmosphere of night, of objects at night, and it's quite a good challenge to tackle if you are a painter, to try to do things in different, with a different light quality. Oh yeah. Yeah, so I guess I put a bunch of still lifes in here. Oh, this is another animation. I'll just talk over it, but it's called River Table, and I started picking up the trash in the river, which was like a conveyor belt of trash that kept coming. And I started picking it up and making paintings from it. I probably made like 100. They were featured in the Museum of Fine Arts in St. Pete at the last Skyway. I had several of them there. I also made this animation where one thing I like about this is it's sort of on the edges. I didn't intend to show that, but I had the camera zoomed back, and that's me working. So that's like on the edges, there's my palette paper, and there's like all the tools. Sometimes a brush will fall there. Sometimes, like, you know, there's countless, my hand got in there, countless objects to make these objects sort of move, and they'll get lined up on the side and ready to put into the animation while the oil paint is moving. So I ended up showing it with that process because I thought it was more visually kind of arresting that way. And that also showed at the MFA in St. Pete. Okay, now here's one of those still lifes I did with the trash. I did a ton of these. I got kind of tired of doing them, so I still consider them, like, I'm ready to do more, but I haven't done any in a year or so. Oh, that's not supposed to say Indies. It's all in the gallery on it, but whatever. I had a little period last year where I painted like dying lilies, and then this showed on this site, the David Zwirner Gallery platform. That was exciting. And this is it. I don't know. I put more stuff in if I needed it, but I think there's a lot of kind of up and down. That was perfect timing in art life, you know. So I thought this would be a good ending image. Maybe I should just say life in general. You have your ups and you have your downs. So here it is, trampoline as a metaphor. And that's it. Do you guys have any questions?
Sounds,
you know, you could like, but then there's all these sites where you can get sound effects. But you can just go and with the recorder and like need a car door sound. A lot of the sounds you need are like doors opening and closing. At least I need. I always need doors. So I'm out there, click, you know. And the funny thing with sound is if you just put it there, like in the right place, roughly. It just, even if the sound of a door closing, you just go like that, like our mind will just say, yeah, that's right. The door closed, even if it's like, or if you just go poof, like we'll just believe it. So you don't have to be perfect with it. Yeah, the sound part, it adds a whole other dimension, but it's amazing how much like the viewer fills in.
In terms of time, how long does an animation generally take you?
Yeah, they take a while. The first one I did, which What Visions Burn, which was my thesis project, I spent like 4 months on it. But it was 4 months of, and I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't see this narrative. I was just attracted to images, and I happened to be painting about art heists. And so it just made sense that I would make a video about that. But then it got this like whole convoluted narrative. But I finished it like just in time for the thesis. And that, yeah, I mean, that was probably really in, like, real studio hours, that would probably be like 8 minutes, because I was really going crazy on that one. But I was also so invigorated by and kind of inventing that process, or, you know, animation has been around forever, but I didn't know it. It was really fun. I mean, I highly recommend doing something you don't know how to do, because you'll come up, like, your mind just gets working on it. You know, you'll come up with solutions, and those solutions, I think, maybe sometimes are the most interesting thing. You know, how you solve that problem. I was telling you about the thing with the light. There's countless ones of those. Every single frame is a solution. The thing that frustrates me about painting, especially oil painting, is I often, especially if you're working with representation, you become like rote with it, and you sort of like learn a technique, and then the solutions become like something that you don't actively think about anymore. And I don't, that's like the man in the box. Like, I don't like that. The thing about inventing something new is you have to solve a new thing and come up with like an absurd solution, or, you know, it might be a reasonable solution, but it, I think the art comes in that problem solving. I really believe that.
The one with the IKEA that you wanted to do over, I was interested in how you, well, first of all, I had two comments. I thought there was a lot of new descending a staircase kind of imagery there.
Mm-hmm.
And then, but the main question I had was, it looks like most of your stop animation is you're using kind of collaged elements, but in that one, you're painting and then wiping and then painting and wiping. Is that what you're doing now?
Exactly, yeah. And all of them have all elements. I have grown to prefer the painting and wiping technique. The collage technique is faster and is useful, but like, there is collage in Stranded in a House too. At the end, I start cutting up those IKEA bits, and then like you have a lamp or something,
yeah.
But it's only partially in the picture, so I had to fill in the parts that weren't. If he's gonna throw it or throw the furniture, like, you know, the picture doesn't have the bottom, so I have to imagine like the legs. Like, that's really stimulating stuff. And one thing fun about animation is like, people will just believe it too. I like that power of like, yeah, you can put a door there or flip that chair over and then it has this kind of leg. Not that it's that important, but everyone will just assume that because it's on video, we're watching it, like, it's gotta be real. Anyway, did I even answer you?
Yeah, okay.
I intend to ramble. This is collage. So I like cut, a lot of times I cut into my paintings. I had to cut these, the bottom of the trampoline. This is a very simple animation, but I had to make this like dumb bit of black that's bigger and smaller. It's just like an envelope, enlarging and shrinking, that I could fit underneath the little legs of the trampoline. That's even, I think it's funny when I think about it. And then the guy, the boy, he's like a little puppet that I made. I don't think his knees even bend, but his like arms kind of bend. But the magic of this one is that part, like that.
Yeah.
Those like four different stages of black underneath is like where like this thing succeeds to me. But anyway, yeah, this was a you know, painting like this big, and I put the camera on it, and then yeah, there's no painting and wiping involved in this one, but I just do what is needed. I have an idea. The idea is often pretty dumb. Like I'm trampoline, and yeah, this one I didn't need to do the painting and wiping. I started to prefer that method because I like how it's just uncontrolled it is. And it does get that new descending the staircase vibe, as especially if you're working on IKEA ads, that paper sucks up some of the paint, so you can't get it all off.
Right. Yeah, I was wondering too about, sorry to stick on the IKEA one.
Okay,
but on the IKEA one,
I am redoing that this year. Because I'm frustrated. I really love that one, and I didn't finish it right.
It's really good. I wondered, did you come up with the whole, because in animation, I would imagine that there has to be some like planning, and like, but in that one, I wondered, did you come up with the crashing of furniture while you were doing, like, hey, wouldn't it be fun if this guy started throwing furniture around? Or was that kind of concept the whole?
I think the concept, original concept was like, you know, you get those fat IKEA catalogs, and I had made paintings. I had borrowed imagery from them before, like to do an interior or something. Just like, oh, I need a kitchen. And then like, oh, here's one. But then, yeah, just the thought of like subverting them. Like, to me, I like it when if art can somehow get into like normal life a little bit. I feel like art is often like over here in the special art place, and then so to me it was exciting that the original idea was exciting just because it was like this is something that people have looking to improve their living room or bathroom or whatever. So it's like a way of kind of getting art into just everyday life. And then as I was doing it, I thought I didn't know how to end it. It could just go on forever. And I thought, yeah, the guy, the pink blob that is a guy, is me, kind of, or whatever, has gotta somehow try to get out of there. But how's he gonna do it? Because even when he goes down the stairs, he ends up back in there. And then it came to me that the jumping out, he's got like, you know, I was probably looking at one of the pictures, like there's a window. I hadn't even thought of the window, I've just been doing doors. So that was like a breakthrough, if windows exist. And then, yeah, then it tied into the mattress thing. I mean, you create a logic, I think, through the world that you make that ends up just kind of propelling itself. And it's, I mean, the mattress idea is a dumb idea, but then it starts to like get into other pieces, and I don't know, I probably didn't. Did I answer your
question? Yeah, and then you wake up and it's stuck again.
Well, and I like the idea of a piece that doesn't end. You know, to me there's something like mythological about that. And yeah, so it's like small, but then it gets big in your mind or something. Anyway, I really do like that piece, and I'm frustrated with it, so I am going to redo it soon. So maybe I'll post it when I do. Anybody else have questions?
I was wondering if, like, you start painting, you know, a regular, I don't know, your box, like a still life or whatever, let's say. Mm-hmm. Or whatever image you're painting, and then you moved on to things like this. Like, how did it affect when you go back to like painting a still life or, you know, a scene or?
Well, one thing I've started doing lately is that I've tried to stop calling it still life and call it painting objects, which to me, actually, it's a small thing, but it makes a big difference because objects are from life. And it's really interesting, like it's volatile when you put one object together with another, like what kind of meanings come out. Well, still life is like the staying on a table, and I love that tradition. I'm a huge fan of many of my favorite artists, pretty much all of them also painted still life. But I find that when you say that word, you think of, I don't know, even if you think of the best still lifes in history, maybe like Van Gogh, it's a tabletop with a spectacular color and some fruit and maybe like a swirly background or something. But it kind of like gets stuck in that world, and I started calling them objects, paintings of objects. And so I can open that parameter up. This might be just my own little head tweak and not relevant, but it's important to me. I find and how that impacts, well, that's because I want my work to sort of get into my life and be like maybe the boundary is not totally hard, you know? So some of the objects I'll paint, I'm working on a bunch of paintings of objects right now for a show in Miami at Mindy Sullivan in February. And some of them are like personal things and some of them are just like junk on the street, yeah, like mattresses or whatever, but
mattress is something, because it's also like you lie on it and it's like really intimate, but then it's also like you go on the street and it's like the size of a big painting. Anyway, it's an opportunity. I think the paintings of objects are still like, it's an opportunity to get like really intimate with, you know, this setup, and you can do it like all the time. Like if you're working with models, or if you're painting plein air or painting like landscape, you know, if the light changes, then you're like you're kind of, the day is over. But with still life, you can just, you know, just do it. Or more and more I paint for my imagination. So anyway, there's no limitation. I like that about it. But I like the sort of bleeding over of just like normal life and just everything else that it, I think it allows for. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Does that answer your question? Mm-hmm.
It's like, even though they're not moving, it actually, well, it's going to change the way I look at things, because it could be sitting still, but it's like that moment of it sitting still. And like, then this kind of thinks, you know, everything has a life, and you're just capturing that one moment of that.
Yeah, exactly. I like that.
Yeah.
I like that. But it's also like things that are really fun to paint that like your brush just likes to do. You know, I think you have to be having fun, otherwise it will look like you're not having fun. So I like the shape of a mattress. I like those forms that I get, I'm attracted to paint. I like the brush being able to move a certain way. So I'm attracted to certain objects that kind of do that. Maybe the trash. I got kind of bored of like being stuck within that wall cup or something. I don't know if you guys have seen. I've done tons of those trash still lifes. You can see on my Instagram. It became too, like, I'm still putting trash in these paintings, but now it's not just the trash. Anyway, sorry, I just started to ramble. Yeah. Anybody else have questions?
Thank you.
It's my pleasure. Thanks for having me.